you. If it is strength, he's got you. God has got you. Cast our burdens on him. And watch him work. Amen? Hallelujah. Let's go. Come on, put your hands together. Come on, y'all, say,
Almighty God, my Redeemer, my hiding place, my safe refuge, no other name like Jesus, no power can stand against you. My feet are planted on this rock, and I will not be shaken. My hope, it comes from you alone, my Lord and my salvation. Your praise is always on my lips, your word is living in my heart, and I will praise you with a new song. My soul will bless you, Lord. Fill my life with greater joy. Yes, I delight myself in you, and I will praise you with a new song. My soul will bless you, Lord.
Hey, come on, put those hands together. Say, Almighty God.
Almighty God, my Redeemer, my hiding place, my safe refuge. No other name like Jesus, no power can stand against you. My feet are planted on this rock, and I will not be shaken. My hope, it comes from you alone, my Lord and my salvation. Your praise is always on my lips. So will bless you, Lord. You fill my life with greater joy. Yes, I delight myself in you, and I will praise you with a new song. My soul will bless you, Lord.
When I'm weak, you make me strong.
Come on.
All things are possible. All things are possible. All things are possible.
Say your praise.
Your praise is always on my lips.
Your word is living.
Your word is living in my heart. And I will praise you with a new song. My soul will bless you, Lord.
You fill
my joy. Yes, I delight myself in you, and I will praise you with a new song. My soul will bless you, Lord.
When I am weak, you make me strong.
When I'm poor, I know I'm rich, for in the power of your name.
Let me hear you say, say.
All things are possible. All things are possible. All things are possible.
Hallelujah. God has got us. Amen. Let's go to Psalms 5 is our scripture today. And we are going to read the whole chapter. It's not that many verses, y'all. But it says, listen to my words, Lord. Consider my lament. Hear my cry for help, my King and my God, for to you I pray. In the morning, Lord, you hear my voice. In the morning, I lay my request before you and wait expectantly. For you are not a God who is pleased with wickedness. With you, evil people are not welcome. The arrogant cannot stand in your presence. You hate all who do wrong. You destroy those who tell lies. The bloodthirsty and deceitful you, Lord, detest. But I, by your great love, can come into your house in reverence. I bow down towards your holy temple. Lead me, Lord, in your righteousness. Because of my enemies, make your way straight before me. Not a word from their mouth can be trusted. Their heart is filled with malice. Their throat is an open grave. With their tongues they tell lies. Declare them guilty, O God. Let their intrigues be their downfall. Banish them for their many sins, for they have rebelled against you. But let all who take refuge in you be glad. Let them ever sing for joy. Spread your protection over them, that those who love your name may rejoice in you. Surely, Lord, you bless the righteous. You surround them with your favor as with a shield. God is faithful, amen? He is faithful. And we will worship him this morning as that faithful God. Dance over me while I am unaware. You sing all around, but I never hear the sound. Say, Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you. How you love me. Dance over me while I am unaware. You sing all around, but I never hear the sound. And Lord, I'm amazed. wide.
How wide. How deep. How great is your love for me.
Can you sing?
Clean me up inside. You thought I was to die for.
You thought I was.
my life.
I will praise you
forever.
I will give you glory.
Forever.
I will live for you.
Forever.
I will exalt
forever.
You. I will lay down
forever.
My life. I will heal my
forever.
Head. I will lift my
forever.
Head.
So I can be free. So I can be whole. So I can tell everyone I know.
You thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping, so you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for, so you sacrificed your life so I could be free. I could be whole, and I could tell everyone I know. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
We worship you, Lord.
Yes, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Worship, Jesus.
We worship you, Lord. We say thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for your love being so deep that you chose to suffer for our freedom, Father God. Thank you for your love being so deep that even knowing that there would be times where we would discredit your name, where we wouldn't believe, where we would talk about you, turn our backs on you, you still said, I am sacrificing my life for you because my love is that great. My love is that deep. My love is that intense. My love is that perfect that I'm not concerned about how you're receiving it. But I'm going to continue to give it because I know my love will change you. Thank you for being a rock, a solid foundation, Father God. Thank you, Father God. We thank you, Father God.
Bless your name, Jesus. Bless your name, Jesus.
Say glory to the God who changed my life. Hallelujah. Worthy are you, Lord. Worthy are you, Lord. Worthy are you, Lord. Worthy are you, Lord. We worship you today. We worship you today. So, in full transparency, we've gone back and forth with this list this morning and had an inordinate amount of changes that we usually have in prepping for today's service. And I know God is in it. I know God is in it. We are going to do When I Think About the Lord. All right, so you can... I believe this morning, God wants to remind us that He is in our corner, that He is fighting for us. Because sometimes what you're going through seems like you're going through it alone. Sometimes there's a guilt that won't let you receive or accept or walk in the power of what He did on the cross for us. And sometimes we need to be reminded. And that's what I'm feeling this morning. Mm-hmm. When I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up and turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground, it makes me wanna shout, say hallelujah, thank you Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me wanna shout, say hallelujah, thank you Jesus, say, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. When I think, so when I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, and how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the earth. Hey, so when I think about the Lord, how he picked me up, he picked me up, turned me around, how he raised my feet, right now my feet are on solid ground.
On solid ground,
it makes me want to shout,
say
hallelujah, thank you Jesus.
Hey,
Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise.
It makes me
want to shout,
come on, sing,
hallelujah, thank you Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. Saved me, how he raised me,
how he
filled me with the Holy Ghost,
see how
he healed me to the uttermost.
Oh,
when I think about the Lord, how he picked me up and turned me around,
said,
how he placed my feet on solid ground.
Let me hear you say,
it makes me want to shout, Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah, thank you Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah, thank you Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me wanna shout, hallelujah, thank you Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise.
Hallelujah, we thank you, Lord.
And all of
we thank you, Lord.
And all of the praise.
Thank you, Jesus.
You just have to remember. You have to think about it. See, some of us, it doesn't take too much to remember that we was messed up. that we didn't have a way to God, that we couldn't get there on our own, that we were broken, that we were hurting, that we were struggling, that we thought we had something, but we could never reach it. We thought we were good enough, but we never were. When you just stop, and sometimes we get too used to being saved, that we forgot, but he actually chose us. He found us worthy even in the midst of our mess, even in the midst of our disobedience and our rebellion and our selfishness. He still chose to come and get us. He did it for us. I have this picture in my head. Be patient with me. Y'all know I have this like illustrations, okay? I need Jeremiah, can you come up here, please? I just need us to picture this just a little bit closer to reality. Come on up, young man. Thank you. And I was thinking about this reality of life before Jesus. This is where we were, okay? And the peace of God, relationship with God, the solid ground, the firm ground, it rests over here. So Jeremiah, I know you're a strong young man. I need you to jump from here to those stairs without anything touching the ground. Go ahead. Yeah, jump. Oh, no, you get one jump. You just failed, son. Try it again. All the way. I know. Do your best. Give it your best. Sorry, you didn't make it. Try one more time. Like, put your whole body into it. If you have to lay on the ground to get there, go for it. In all of our effort, in all of your striving, in all of your church going, in all of your quoting scripture, in all of your washing and cleansing yourself, in all of your efforts, whether good, bad, or ugly, you can never make it there on your own. In your own power. But Jesus was compassionate. He was loving, and he found you worthy, Jeremiah. He found each of us worthy. And so he says, I'm going to show up and make a way, because you can't do it. All I'm going to ask, Jeremiah, is that you trust me and you give yourself to me. And if you jump in my arms, I'm going to get you where you need to go. In fact, actually, let me make this even easier for you, because Jesus chose to humble himself. I'm going to make it simple, but I need you to trust me. Your feet are not going to hit this ground of sin and death. But I'm going to make a way as I sacrifice myself so that you can get to relationship with the Father. Do you want to go there? Jesus said, I'll be the way. I'll make the sacrifice. I'll suffer the consequence of sin and death that had to be paid, because I needed somebody to be a perfect sacrifice, because you couldn't get there on your own. You couldn't get there by yourself, and you may be tired, and you may be feel like you've tried to figure out how to live this life. And Jesus saying, all I'm asking you to do is to surrender yourself and trust me. And he already laid his arms out on the cross. He laid his body out so that you could walk over him into relationship with the Father. that you can find your way as he picks you up and turns you around, and he'll place your feet on the solid ground of everlasting life, which is knowing the Father here, now, and forever. And so as we take this moment to celebrate and observe communion together, take your cup. Thank you, Pastor. There's juice on one side and a cracker on the other. This is us remembering that we were here, that we had no way to get to the Father God on our own efforts. Thank you, baby. But Jesus came to earth in humility as a servant to give his very life for us. And we don't want to abuse that. We don't want to neglect that. We don't want to take that for granted. But we take this moment today to remember and to honor. Hallelujah. We take this moment to honor the Lord that saved us, took us out of our brokenness, out of our pain, out of our separation from God, and provided a way through his perfect blood being shed for us and his body being broken for us. So let's first take the bread that represents his life, pierced, broken, sacrificed for each of us. And just as I tried to demonstrate, he asked us to believe, to confess, and to repent, which is to turn, to stop doing it your own way. Stop living in your own methods and your own attempts, your own purposes for your own glory, and just surrender to him and trust. Even now, if you haven't made that choice, you can make that choice right now that says, I get it, Jesus, I need you. I want to surrender my life to you, my heart to you, and I want to follow you as you lead me. And those of us that have already made that commitment, whether it was yesterday or decades ago, we're still grateful because he found us worthy and he chose to save us from the consequence of sin and death. And someday our bodies will be left here on earth, but we will not die because our spirit will be with him. And we celebrate that now, that we get to know him here in part, and we will know him in whole someday. And so, take just a moment. Consider all he's done, and even just thank him if you need to. As we take a moment of silence, and then he'll lead us to partake this cracker, this bread together. Lord, as you've instructed us, we do this as we remember what you have done for us. And it's only because of you that we have found the purpose of our life, to share in relationship with the Father that created us and to live out his mission here on earth. And so, saints, let's partake of this together as we remember what Jesus did for us. When Jesus took that time prior to his death to meet with his disciples, he instructed them first to take the bread, and then he gave them this cup, and he said it represents his blood that he was about to shed. Jesus' sacrificial act didn't just require a good deed. It required him giving his whole life as a perfect sacrifice. And so as we take this, we remember that he bled for us, that he covered our imperfection in his perfection, He covered our unrighteousness and his righteousness. And now it says that the Lord God, the Father, he sees us just as he sees Jesus. And he loves us in that same way because the Son paid the price for us, his children. And now we have this new covenant. It's an eternal promise that we get to be with him forever. Those of us who believe and follow him as his disciples. Let's partake of this cup together. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
How he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost.
I'm sorry.
How he healed me to the uttermost when I think about the Lord. How he picked me up and turn me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus.
Lord, you're worthy
of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah, thank you, Lord, you're worthy
all the glory
and all the honor and all the
praise. One more time.
It makes me want to shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout. Hallelujah.
Amen. There we go. Praise God. Praise God. Go ahead and take your seat. And as you do, can you just give us a big thank you, Lord? Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, I want to take a moment and just officially greet you and welcome you to the Silent Dove Church this morning. We strive to live spirit-led and compassion-driven. And that's the call that God has given us, and we, in his strength, we try to live that out each and every day. We want to welcome any visitors that we have today, especially any first-time visitors. We won't ask you to say anything or sing a song or give us your whole life story, but we do want to know who you are and like to see your smiling face. If you're here for the very first time, if you could just slip your hand in the air, wave it for us. Say, all right, there we go. A couple folks here, one here. Praise God. Praise God. Well, Silent Dove family, what do we love saying to our visitors? Yes, we love you with the love of the Lord, and we hope that you feel that. We're loved by the Lord, and we just like to share it because it's that good. We just like to share it. So we thank you for joining us. Grateful that you're here today. If you're watching online with us and you're new, we welcome you as well, and we love you also. So praise God. Amen. I'm going to actually take a few minutes and just share some announcements with you. We're going to do that now. We usually do it at the end, but we're going to do it a little different today and just share a few announcements with you. Ladies, a couple things for you to be aware of. There is a bowling outing coming up on March 23rd. So if my math is good, that's next Saturday. Next Saturday, ladies, from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m., Bertrand Lanes in Waukegan. There's some food and some time to go bowl, hang out in fellowship. It's just good to be together and to do some activities. So I hope that you will sign up in the back. If you haven't already, you can take care of that and get your name on the list so that you ladies can get out and have some good time together. Amen? Okay, I think a few people were at least excited about that. All right, another thing for the ladies. Oh, it's an updated slide. Praise God. Look at Apostle Deborah. Doesn't she look good up there? She got the... I was going to make a comment about the same hair today, but I won't say anything. She's looking at me with that look. I love my mother-in-law. Praise the Lord. The Apostle Deborah Stackhouse is the keynote speaker, okay? Renew 2024, presented by Harry Stackhouse Ministries. This, ladies, you should go bowling, but you should really go to this, okay? If you have to pick one, go to both. But get signed up. Okay, Renew 2024, it's a one-day event on May 4th. I don't know if you can read the details, but it's May 4th, 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. at the Doubletree Hotel in Pleasant Prairie. There's some other beautiful ladies on there, too, including my wife is going to be a part of that. Latay Jervis, Shawnee Ratliff, just a powerful team of speaking, of praying, interceding, spending time in God's Word together, and eating and fellowshipping. So the truth is... I don't know if you feel like your battery is on 90% or 9%, but wherever you're at, you always need some more. You need to be charged up, because even though I preached about it last, like, we do get a little weary sometimes. We do need some re-strengthening, and God has designed it so that when the believers get together, and whether it's brothers or sisters, in this case, when the sisters get together, there's an empowerment that comes, one, just from connecting in fellowship, but then receiving the word and being in worship together, you're going to be powered up. You're going to be strengthened. And so if you need just a little bit, come. If you need a lot, definitely come. And you know somebody that needs something, invite them to come so that y'all can be charged up. And then that Saturday, we'll have so many women in this sanctuary, we won't know what to do, men. We just have to join along and get powered up ourselves. Amen. So get signed up. There is a fee, but it's reasonable. Pay your $50. There's a QR code. There's more information in the back. Just find a way to get there and help somebody else to come too. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Oh, this is another big announcement. So I was going to ask you to do the math, but if you subtract 2024 from 1989, you get, oh, y'all can read, praise God, 35 years the Sign of the Dove Church has been in existence. Yeah, I think we should be excited about that. Some of y'all been here the whole time, so you should really be excited. Amen. It's a testimony to God's faithfulness and his goodness, because a lot of ministries don't last. Churches don't last, and that's not always their fault. It's a challenge. It's a challenge to stay faithful, to work and advance God's kingdom, and for people to still like each other after all that time, and to still want to be together and serve God together. It's not easy. So we want to celebrate that. Y'all want to celebrate that with us? We're telling you now, I mean, it's not super early, but it's early enough that you can rearrange if you have to. You can try to find a way to get there. We're going to do a whole weekend of celebration. August 2nd, Friday night, we're going to start with the banquet in the evening. You can get dressed up, look good, smell good, come out and eat good, and just enjoy some good time together. Saturday, we're going to have a picnic, a barbecue together, and like we usually do, our annual picnic, but we're integrating that into the celebration of the weekend. We'll be back at Bowen Park on a Saturday afternoon, kind of family reunion style. And then Sunday morning, we'll come here and have a special day of worship and reflecting and remembering and honoring God what he has done for 35 years. And he's not through yet. But there's, God values celebration and remembrance, because we want to appreciate and be grateful for what he has done. And so we're going to take a whole week and do that. More details to come. Start your little layaway account if you need to. We'll give you some financial details later. It's going to be reasonable, but we want everyone to be there. Amen? Amen. Praise God. Deacon Jeff, come on up and share your important announcement. Excited about a new growth group that he's going to be leading us in.
Well, good morning, saints. How many of y'all know that budgeting your money is a biblical principle? Yeah? It says in Proverbs 21:5, good planning and hard work leads to plenty. How many of y'all need some plenty at the end of the month? Yeah, yeah. It also says that as surely as haste leads to poverty. Sometimes we're too hasteful. So there's a survey that says that most people in America budget, but a lot of them don't stick to it. All right, tell on yourself this morning. How many of y'all budget? How many of you budget? Raise your hands. All right. Okay. So if budgeting is a biblical principle and not a lot of us are budgeting, well, you make the conclusion. Okay. So listen, I might be excited about budgeting, but I am no fool to think that most people are excited about budgeting money, just like most people aren't excited about exercising. Right. But we love the results, don't we? Well, so I'm going to tell you a little testimony. I've been budgeting probably since the beginning of my marriage. You know, having a family, you got to make things happen, right? But I'm going to tell you, I've seen God more potently when I'm budgeting than when I'm not. Because now I can see how God made it happen. The budget isn't what makes it happen. It's God that makes it happen. But when you budget and you plan well your money, then you can see how God makes the ends meet. And you can see where you fall short. So next month, what we're going to do, and I want to get as many people in this class as possible, because I only see a few hands that went up for budgeting. On Sunday morning, on the 7s, 7, 14, 21, 28, at 8:45 in the morning, I want to see you in the budgeting class. Because God's got to do something. And he's going to work through us. See, he partners through us, right? We can say, oh, God, do this, do that, do that. But then we don't put feet to it. It ain't going to get done. So that's what God's been teaching me. And I want you guys to join the class so we can all come together, unified, to see what God can do. All right? God bless you.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. And one last announcement. Just want to remind you, we're still using our money to pour into our young people and help support them get to Kids Across America camp this summer. So before you leave, there will be coffee from Uganda on sale in the table in the back, and it's all a fundraiser. So just want to mention that. All right, why don't you stand to your feet? We're going to take up our collection, our gifts, our offering, our tithes. We're going to give them to the Lord this morning. Because we do want to be faithful with what he's given us to give back and to contribute the work that he's doing. I'm thankful for this group that Deacon Jeff is starting so that we can have more. Because God wants us to have plenty, not just so we can sit back, relax, and enjoy every little thing, but so that we can help others to have what they need. And that's part of what we do every week as we give this gift. It's a demonstration of God. I want to be a part of helping to bless your work and to bless others that may even need it more than me. And I'm grateful for what you've given me. And so I'm willing to sacrifice and give back so that together the needs of the body are met. Together we can advance God's kingdom and impact more people by his good news. Amen. So in a moment, I'm going to ask you to either come to the front on your own and give if you have something to place in the basket. If you prefer, you can give electronically through Cash App, TSODWK, or through our website, thesignofthedove.org, via PayPal. And however you give, just give from your heart, give cheerfully, and give because you're grateful. Amen? At the conclusion of the offering, after I pray and you come forward, we're going to invite both our children and our teenagers to head downstairs for a time of fellowship and studying God's word and learning and growing together. Amen. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we can never repay you for the work that you have done for us to save us, to transform us, to heal us, to deliver us, to free us. Oh, God, there's so much you've done for us. But because we're grateful, we're choosing to give to you today. And I pray that everyone would have that heart where it's grateful, cheerful, generous, sacrificial giving that we lay before you today because we love you. And we want to be a part of sharing that love, of blessing others, and of sharing your good news so that those who don't know it can come into a relationship with you. We thank you for all the gifts we have. God, the truth is most of us do have more than we need, and we thank you for it. And Lord, let us be sacrificial today so that the real needs can be met in other people's lives. And we believe your word, that where you've said, God, you do pour out blessings so that we can continue to bless others. God, we don't want to be selfish. Let us be generous. And let these gifts be pleasing into your eyes, we pray today in Jesus' name. Amen. So please come on your own as you have a gift to give. Otherwise, we'll be back in a moment with the prepare to receive the word of the Lord. We just lost 2/3 of the church. Hey, praise God for the children and the youth. Some of y'all have been fruitful and multiplied. Amen. Amen. Well, those of us who are over the age of 18, I hope we're excited to still be here together. And we have a really special honor today because, one, we get to dig into God's word together. Anytime you get to receive the truth of his word, and to have others join in that, to me, that's a special time. So it's always special, but we're especially grateful that we're going to have one of our own share God's word with us. And though she has, quote unquote, preached in Uganda, I believe this is the first time she's preached here in this building, and we are excited. God has been working powerfully in her life. You've seen her up here leading prayer and sharing prophetic word and just having a little bit of fire occasionally. A little is an understatement, but we praise God for the fire of the Spirit that he is stirring up in her. And as God has been propelling her to new heights and new places, Pastor Corey and I have just really felt like it was time to just encourage her to step into this space and allow God to use her in the preaching and the teaching of the word, and to let that gift flourish, let that fire flourish. And I know God is going to pour into all of us today. So get your Bible ready if you've got it with you. Get something to take some notes with, because there's going to be some good things for your life and for our lives. And let's just welcome our sister, Lete Jervis. Amen. Praise God.
Good morning. Y'all, I don't get nervous often, right? But it's something about having to stand before God's people with the word, to be entrusted with that, right? It's a very serious thing. And so that has been heavy on me, right? But I am excited. I know that God does have a word for us today. The beautiful thing is, to you guys, I have to say, I have so many of my friends from work that have come to be here with me. I have people that are connected to our family that have come. I have people that haven't been here in a while but are lifting me up. And when we were singing, you thought I was worth saving. It's overwhelming. A lot of times we see what the finished product looks like, right? But y'all, I was a mess. Like a for real mess. Like Pastor Deborah, Pastor Harry, like crying out, interceding mess for years. And to stand before you today is very, very humbling. This is my parents' anniversary. God has a way of doing things, right? He has a way of doing things. I don't know. I have a lot of notes because I am that teacher that needs to be overprepared than underprepared. But I honestly am going to let God do what he wants to do. All right? So we're going to just start with prayer. You're so good, Daddy God. And I thank you, Lord, that you have commissioned me and that this is a year that I have given you my full yes. I pray, oh God, that your Holy Spirit will rest on me, that you will speak through me, that you will do whatever you want to do in this room. I know, oh God, that there are people in here that need freedom. And so I pray, oh God, that your Holy Spirit will ignite a flame in me, oh God, that I can deliver the word only the way that you want to, that I move out of the way. God, I put all my weight on you. I put all my weight on you. And I trust, oh God, that you are going to do it, that you are going to meet people where they are, that people are going to experience freedom today. So God, I pray that you will speak through me and that you will have your way. I give all of me to you. Not me, but you. I decrease so that you can increase. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen. As you guys can see, right, on the screen, the title of this message is What's Taunting You? What's Taunting You? And I'm coming from 1 Samuel chapter 17, which is the story of David and Goliath. I know many of us are familiar with that. But I think that there's going to be just a little bit of some different truths that kind of we can walk away with today. So you should have your notebook out. Maybe have some tissue. Maybe have on some running shoes. I don't care what you need to do, but we want to get free today. All right? So let's start. Amaya, you can turn to the next slide. We want to just define taunting. I'm sorry that that's so little, y'all. Okay? Let me get my slides up over here, too, because it's a little bit easier for me to see. Y'all see I got my glasses on and stuff. All right. So taunting, it's a verb, right? To reproach in sarcastic, insulting, or a jeering manner, mock. To mock. Some of us don't necessarily see taunting. It's not always necessarily this bad thing or whatever. Many of you know that I am a Stackhouse. That's my maiden name, but I'm also a Jervis. And to be honest with you, from both sides of the family, the one I'm married into and the one that I was born into, we are competitive. We are competitive people. To the point of we will talk about you, we will mess with you, we will come for you when we are playing a game. You see my brother shaking his head, my sister, my mother. Don't let Apostle Deborah fool you. She does it too. Apostle Harry was the same way. All of us. Well, my freshman year in college, I was at the University of Louisville, my first semester. And I had some friends on the same floor in the dorm room, and we would get together and we would play like games. So we would play Uno and different things like that. I'm not a big spades person, though I can play it. I don't really play it, but I play Unos like people play spades. All right. And in that, I remember one time we were playing Uno. And now, you guys, we're not playing that new school Uno. Stack and draw twos and what else y'all do? pull till you get the card you need, playing a draw four when you got the color in your hand. No. No, you cannot put that draw four because she got Uno when you still got blue. Put that blue card down, right? That was the type of Uno we were playing. And I don't know, how many of you have taken score playing Uno? That's how you play real Uno. If you haven't done it, you've never played real Uno. You don't know who the real winner is, okay? I'm just going to tell you that. I've been a real winner playing Uno because I have actually had the lowest score, right? All right, so there's this girl. She's one of my friends, mind you, right? We're in the dorm. And y'all, we get into this game of Uno. We're keeping score. We're doing all of that. And I start going in. Like, hey, you can't handle this. Girl, what you out here for? What you doing? Da-da-da, you don't know what you doing. Yada, 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 yada. Y'all, she gets tearful. Playing Uno. Like, she for real started, like, crying. I was like, you the weakest link. Like, I'm coming for you. I mean, like, it was bad, y'all. Okay? In hindsight, I kind of feel bad. Okay? And I already knew, before the tears really fully formulated, that I was taunting her. I was taunting her. I didn't relent. And this is how the enemy has been doing some of you. He's been taunting you. And he's relentless. He's not stopping. He doesn't care if you show up in church. He's still taunting you. It doesn't matter if you haven't fully surrendered. He's still taunting you. Now, the taunt doesn't just stop just because I say that I'm saved and I'm walking with God. He is going around seeking whom he can devour. Right? Whom he can devour. So as we get into this word today, I want you to think about it. I want you to be thinking through your mind because I have some tools and different ways that we need to kind of attack these giants in our lives, whether they are huge and known or hidden and just as dangerous. But I need you all to understand that it's time to put the enemy on ice. And I'm going to tell you what that means in just a second. But as you think about this, some of you have been taunted and in tears for days, weeks, months, years, and he's still not relenting. Well, we're serving him notice today. All right? We're going to start with this word. So many of you know the you can go to the next slide. Thank you, Amaya. Know the story of David and Goliath, right? And how David goes and he basically kills the giant. And we're going to kind of talk through each of that, okay? I want to read the first part first. And then as after we do that, I'm going to give you our first point, okay? Then Goliath, a Philistine champion from Gath, came out of the Philistine ranks to face the forces of Israel. He was over 9 feet tall. He wore a bronze helmet, and his bronze coat of mail weighed 125 pounds. He also wore bronze leg armor, and he carried a bronze javelin on his shoulder. The shaft of his spear was heavy and thick as a weaver's beam, tipped with an iron spearhead that weighed 15 pounds. His armor bearer walked ahead of him carrying a shield. Goliath stood and shouted a taunt across to the Israelites. Why are you all coming out to fight? He called. I'm the Philistine champion, but you are only the servants of Saul. Choose one man to come down here and fight me. If he kills me, then we will be your slaves. But if I kill him, you will be our slaves. I defy the armies of Israel today. Send me a man who will fight me. When Saul and the Israelites heard this, they were terrified and deeply shaken. Putting the enemy on ice requires us first to identify the enemy. Identify and know his tactics. Identify and know the enemy's tactics. So I'm going to give you four that I kind of got from this, all right, from this word. That we have to recognize, right, that the enemy is real and he has one goal, that is to annihilate you. And if people don't tell you that, they're not truly your friend. He wants to annihilate you. I didn't say hurt you. I said annihilate you. He wants to destroy you. He is the enemy of your soul. He does not care what it takes to destroy you, but that's what he's trying to do. And some of you are partnering with him. He's real. Second is, he uses intimidation and taunts us. In verse 8, right, it says, Goliath stood and shouted a taunt across to the Israelites. He's calling you out. He's taunting, intimidating. Now, mind you, that giant was huge. Y'all saw, like, he's wearing stuff that weighs 125 pounds. That's like a full teenager. That's not a kid. It's like a person. Right? And he's standing there with all this stuff on, something that weighs 15 pounds in one hand, 125 pounds on your body. You're coming up and you're saying something. Yeah, I'm scared. There's something very natural about that because of how big it is. Something very natural about that. But intimidation is a crippler. It cripples us. It's one thing for him to be so big, but for his bite to be so small. When we put it in comparison to our Savior, right? Like, but there is a real thing about what he looked like, right? He was huge. In the third point is that he struts and boasts to show off his strength to attempt to activate fear in you. It's very different when you're intimidating and you don't say anything. You know how people have an intimidating presence, right? Like they walk in and people kind of feel intimidated by them and it's kind of like, woof, they don't really have to say anything. But once they open their mouth, it takes it to the next level. So he's strutting around, right? Like his goal is to actually get us to fear, right? He's to actually, he wants to instill fear in us so that we are paralyzed. So that we are paralyzed. Talks about Goliath going back and forth, like letting them know. Letting them know, yep, what's going on? Mm-hmm. What you doing? You don't have what it takes. You don't have what it takes. I need you to think about a time where you have been paralyzed by fear. Like for real, paralyzed by fear. Right? This might not have been a giant, but you were scared. Right? So I want to share a little story with you guys about this, because I want you to understand that I understand that it's something that is very real. Fear is a very real thing, but it can paralyze you. We went on a family vacation last summer, and we were going ziplining. We were going ziplining. People are afraid of heights. Me being one of them. You're not alone, Pastor Jason. I wasn't going to put you out there, but you said, bless the Lord, so I'm going to just go with it. It was us, Apostle Deborah, Minister Sonia, our kids, Tyson, Maya, Talia, Levi, and Abrielle, and me. Abrielle. We get up there, y'all. Now, you know you always have to, like, climb stairs to get up to the line, right? Like, we're on the, like, fourth flight, and we're still not at the top. So we're all trying to check in on you. Are you all right? You all right? We're like, yeah, we're okay. We're okay. We get to the top. This is the edge, and all you see, they're telling us that you have to get into this harness. They're hooking you on, double checking, making sure that it's, you know, secure, all of that. And they're like, you have like a little strap on, y'all. So just be real. It's a strap that you sit on, and they let you fly across the forest. Okay, so we sit down in it, and Buddy was there, right? Sorry, Anthony was there as well. And so now, y'all, the young people, at least the ones that are older and crazy enough to think that life is invincible, Tyson, Maya, they're like, going, flying off the thing, just going down. I mean, like, there was no fear there. Apostle Deborah did this without Apostle Harry, which is a huge thing, y'all. Because Apostle Deborah, can I just be honest? She could be scary sometimes, y'all. Okay? And so, Mommy goes up there, and we're trying to encourage everybody, and she does it. She was on the edge. She was a little trepidatious, but she did it. I'm towards the end. Jason did it. Sonia did it. Here goes Abrielle. Tali was scared, but she did it. She cried. She did it. Here goes Abrielle. I'm like, go ahead, Bri. It's your turn. You can do it. You can do it. Just try it. And Sonia, can you come in for a second? I'm sorry. She's there, and I'm standing on the side right now. Y'all, I'm scared too. I'm not even hooked up to the thing trying to convince her to go. You're hooked up to the thing, so at least if you fall, something's kept that you're on the thing. I'm standing right here. That there's nothing to catch me. I'm like, Bree, you can do it. She's like, no, I don't want to. I'm like, go, Brie, go. She be me. So yeah, this is what she's doing. I'm like trying to like push her, y'all. She's like doing right. So then she ends up being, I'm like, Brie, you got this, baby. You can do it. I believe in you. You can make it. Go, girl. You got it. She's like, okay, boom. And she goes, flies across. Right? Thank you. Levi, I'm ready to go back down, Mom. I want to go back down. I don't want to do it, Mom. Mom, I don't want to do it. I don't want to do it, Mom. Mom, I can't. I can't do it. I don't want to do it. I'm like, man, you got it. Just try it one time. Come on, baby. You can do it. Don't worry. You can do it. If you don't like it, you don't got to do it again. But at least you got it. You're this far. Come on. You can do it. You can do it, baby. Let's go. Let's go. And he does it. The power of knowing who supports you, who cheers you on, who's your victim. protector. Who's the one that's going to stand by you no matter what? That's our Christ. That's our Father. That's why David understood the taunts of the enemy. He wasn't taken back because you know what he had? He had God saying, I got you. Don't you worry. Baby, you ain't going down. You're not going down. And being able to recognize his tactics, it lets me know the power and the authority of Christ. And being connected to Christ, doesn't matter how unstable it feels. I don't care how it's yelling at you, telling you you'll never kick this habit. You'll never be free. Your family will never be healed. I don't care what he says. I don't care what he says. If you belong to Christ, if you belong to the Savior, nothing can stop you. Nothing can stop you. The last thing is he's persistent. He studies you, and he uses the same tricks. He uses the same tricks. He might try to package it differently. It's the same tricks. It's the same tricks. It's the same tricks. I need you to hear that. It's the same tricks. When you know someone's going to do the same play every time in a football game, what do? You stop them. You know they're going right. You go get them. They not scoring on you. You know that they're not going to drive to the hole. They're going to try to shoot it. So you block them. You stand in front of them. You guard them. You double team them. Get a friend. Get a friend to fight the enemy with you. Double team them. It's nothing new. It's nothing new. In verse 16, it talks about him taunting them again, right? That he like goes in and he's just taunting. And it says like later on in 23 that it was his usual taunts. He shows up with his usual taunts. In verse 16, 40 days he did this to them. We're going to get to 40 days. The reason some of y'all aren't winning is because you don't have enough consistency. You can't stick with it 40 days, and the enemy does. You think 1 week of fasting is enough to keep the enemy off of you 365 days a year? You think coming to church every Sunday morning, lifting up your little praise and your worship is enough to keep him off of you 365 days a year? You think offering a 5-minute prayer before you get up in the morning and all you say is, God, thank you for the day, and don't arm yourself is enough to fight an enemy that comes after you and taunts you and is persistent and studies you and he knows all your little nuances and all the ways to get you to fall off track? You better identify it and stop identifying with him. You better identify the enemy. Identify it. Don't identify with it. Some of you are in a place where you have identified with that thing. Well, that's just who I am. You know, God understands. That's just who I am. I can't get up and pray, you know. I can't stop. I can't fast. My blood sugar get too low. I've been there. We talked about loopholes. Ah. every giant isn't visible. But what you feel still feels like a giant. He might not be taunting you in the same ways where he's so bold and in your face because he knows that maybe you're a little bit mature enough to be like, nah, he can't come at me like that. But he's behind you and he's talking and he's in your ear, and it's these hidden little giants that are just as big and they feel just as big because they paralyze you the same ways. Hidden giants come in the form of excuses, self-reliance, unforgiveness, offense, self-doubt. I'll repeat it. Pride, criticism, disappointment, and mediocrity. Hidden giants come in the form of forms of excuses, self-reliance, unforgiveness, offense, self-doubt, pride, criticism, disappointment, mediocrity. Because some of y'all, we want to act like we don't got giants. We want to act like we don't have Goliaths in our lives. Because I've been walking with God for so long. You can't come for me like that. But when trouble strikes, fear ignites in your core. It ignites in you. That unforgiveness, when that person walks in the room that you haven't forgiven, there's a physical reaction in our bodies. These are just as dangerous, if not more so, dare I say. Because some of them you've gotten so comfortable with. And we live in a society that says it's okay. Everything is okay. I'm going to tell you what, it's not. It's not. And you can't partner with the enemy and overcome him. Do you know his tactics? Think about your life right now. Where does he come for you? Where does he slow you down? Where does he stop you? Where does he have you in a chokehold? See, first you've got to identify it. If you don't identify it, guys, how do you know what to confront? Point number two is that you've got to confront it. Get the proper perspective. David had the proper perspective. Proper perspective only happens when you actually belong to him and are walking with Christ. Don't tell me that you've got the proper perspective and you don't have a life surrendered to Christ. You don't. You don't have the proper perspective. Okay? You don't. Self-help is not it. Cleansing the air with the chakras and all that nonsense, that ain't it. If you had proper perspective, you would understand that the enemy works like that and that he's trapping you and you're inviting spirits in instead of kicking them out. That's how you would really know. It's not in a horoscope. I'm tired of Christians asking me, what's my sign? Girl, what's your sign? You asking me what my sign is, and you talking about you a believer with me, and you believe that they know something about you? Yeah, the devil does know something about you. What you doing about it? I'm a such and such. That's what zodiacs do. Go somewhere with that. I'm confronting it. Get the proper perspective. Proper perspective is the opening of your spiritual eyes. We are blind in the church. You can't fight something you can't see. And so many of us don't see that the enemy is out for us. You're sleeping with him. How do you confront somebody you're in bed with? The proper perspective won't be contaminated by others' experiences if you actually have the proper perspective. Their fear isn't going to shake your fear, isn't going to shake your foundation because you have the proper perspective. So like David goes into the situation. When he enters into the situation, you guys, all of the Israelites and the army are terrified. Saul is terrified. The leader is terrified. And I was reading in a commentary that talked about Saul being afraid, right? And what that means. Sometimes it's like depending on how afraid you are and how paralyzed you are by that fear is a clear indication of how close or how far you are from God. Dr. Tony Evans was talking about that, which is very true. He's not saying that you're not going to experience that feeling of fear, right? Like there's something very human about it. Right? God uses that to alert us of dangers, of different things. It's when the warrior Saul, who's the leader of the people, who has all of the experience to fight, is scared. Who is scared because you're scared? You better preach with me. You better preach with me. Come on. Come on here. I got little people. Y'all don't know. I know how to ignore kids. I'm good at it. All right. Got four of them little jokers. All right. Let's get into the scripture and kind of read through what happened, starting in verse 20. It says, so David left the sheep with another shepherd and set out early the next morning with the gifts as Jesse had directed him. He arrived at the camp just as the Israelite army was leaving for the battlefield with shouts and battle cries. Soon the Israelite and Philistine forces stood facing each other, army against army. David left his things with the keeper of the supplies and hurried out to the ranks to greet his brothers. As he was talking to them, Goliath, the Philistine champion from Gath, came out from the Philistine ranks. Then David heard him shout his usual taunt to the army of Israel. As soon as the Israelite army saw him, they began to run away in fright. Have you seen the giant? The men asked. He comes out every day to defy Israel. The king offered a huge reward to anyone who kills him. He will give that man one of his daughters for a wife, and the man's entire family will be exempted from paying taxes. David asked the soldier standing nearby, what will a man get for killing the Philistine and ending his defiance of Israel? Who is this pagan Philistine anyways that he is allowed to defy the armies of the living God? And these men gave David the same reply. They said, yes, that is the reward for killing him. But when David's older brother, Eliab, heard David talking to the men, he was angry. What are you doing around here anywhere? He demanded. What about those few sheep you're supposed to be taking care of? I know your pride and deceit. You just want to see the battle. What have I done now? David replied. I was only asking a question. He walked over to some others and asked them the same thing and received the same answer. Then David's question was reported to King Saul, and the king sent for him. Here's what the proper perspective looks like. There's a couple of things. I just need to circle back a little bit. David heard the taunting and saw the Israelites' reactions. We see that in verse 24. But he didn't react like they did. He wasn't moved by the crowd. He inquired and assessed the situation and asked questions from the proper perspective, ending his defiance. Who is this pagan Philistine anyway that he's allowed to defy the armies of the living God? Verse 26. Proper perspective puts things in the proper size and place. David knows whom he serves. It's the living God. Do you serve the living God? Do you serve the living God? You have to really know and believe who God says you are and who he is, because the enemy believes it, and that's why he's on attack. I heard a message by Priscilla Shire, and she was talking about how we are defined and how we are children of God and who we are, and how we don't believe it, but the devil does. You gonna let him outbelieve you? That's why he comes after us, because he knows what is in us, right? Like, that's why he's coming. That's why he's trying to get you to silence your mouth. That's why he's having thing after thing after thing come up on you. That's why he's attacking your physical body. That's why he's attacking your mind, because he's trying to get you off course so that you don't think you are who God says you are. That's his goal. His whole thing is to get you to doubt. The enemy wants to get you to doubt, because if he gets you to doubt, he can manipulate you. He can manipulate you. That's when you start entertaining other things. It's when you start trying to do self-help. That's when you start talking about burning sage. I'm not getting off that. I'm sick of it, y'all. People telling me they burning sage. Don't come up in here with that. You keep them demons to yourself. Actually, let's get them out, period. You want to be free? Shoot, get up out of here with that. All right? You could go to the next slide. Proper perspective looks like an identity shaped by Christ, not credentials. I don't feel like I have the credentials to be here, but I gave God a full yes, and I know who he called me to be, and I'm walking in that. So I don't care if you don't like me. I don't care if I say the wrong thing. I'm going to try to do it the way that God tells me to and give him honor and glory, but I can't do it for you. I'm not here for your applause. I'm not here for you to say amen. I'm here for Jesus. It's an audience of one, and some of y'all need to get the same boldness to kind of come up out your seat, because you've been sitting back and the enemy thinks that you don't got a mouth. Open your mouth. Open your mouth. When you aren't, when you don't know your identity, that's why you're scared. You get bold when you know who you are. When I know that God put this word in me, you can't shut me up. I don't care what you gotta say. There's a way that you show up when you are identified with Christ. There's something about having a connection to him. It's something about being able to walk with somebody. It's something about knowing I'm not doing this on my own. Come here, Bubba. It does something for you. Does something for you. And I want y'all to look mean. Look mean, right? Look mean. Like they got some. Do you understand that when I'm like this, that feels a little scary? That feels scary. Like I don't know that I'm going to be able to get past them. Right? I don't know. In my own strength, I might try to go through them, but they're actually stronger than me if they actually do it together. Y'all got to push me. Right? But there's something else. When my identity is wrapped in someone else, I don't even have to walk side by side. I'm just behind them. And I believe that the waters are going to part. I believe that I'm going to be able to walk through with no problems. You got it? Who's in front of you? Who's in front of you?
Who's walking before you? Can't nobody come for me with my brother in front of me, and he's just a human being. You think he's going to let somebody come for me, and I'm his little sister? No, it ain't happening. My nephew ain't going to let it happen. I got too many people up in here that got my back. Apostle Deborah will get up too. Don't mess with her, baby. When I have the proper perspective, nothing stops me. Nothing stops me. Nothing stops me. Nothing stops me. Nothing stops me, Lord. I'm walking with you, God. You're my savior. You're my protector. You're my keeper. You're my equipper. You're the one that sustains me. You're the one that keeps me. Y'all need to get mad at the enemy. I got an accurate assessment of the situation because of who was in front of me. I could actually see it correctly because my protector was there. You think he gonna let you fall? He got a name to represent. And he's trying to get you to think that he's not going to protect his name. He protects his name. He protects his name. It's not in your own strength. It's not in your own name. It's in his. You will get an accurate assessment of the situation. An accurate assessment. Have y'all ever had a time where the assessment wasn't accurate? People don't assess the situation properly. Right? Let's go. Or you talking about, I need a second opinion? We don't need second opinions with Christ. We don't need second opinions. He doesn't get it wrong. He don't get it wrong. I don't care what you feel like. I don't care how he's been beating you down. God doesn't get it wrong. David was not impacted by the other people's fear, including the leader, because he had the proper perspective. He understood that I am shaped by Christ. That is, you're defying the living God? Don't come for me. Don't come for me. Do you got a don't come for me today? Do you got a don't come for me? Let's go, Mike. Me and you, let's go. So he was not moved by the fact that everybody else was moved. Hey, can I get somebody that knows who they are in the midst of a world and a ship that's sinking? Can you stand on who you know you are? Can you stop making excuses? Can you get a little bit of fight? Can you say, God, I'm in the identity of you? Proper perspective. When you get the proper perspective, this is the knowing the who and what is the true enemy. I don't know if y'all caught this, but I'm gonna bring it to you. When you get the proper perspective and have true connection with God, understand there are new haters and old ones. And sometimes it's those that are closest to you. Eliab, in 1 Samuel 16, Samuel is going to anoint David as king. Eliab is his oldest brother. And from what the scripture says, Eliab looked good too, and he was big. Okay, now y'all know they said David is handsome and ruddy and all that stuff, but Eliab actually had the stature. And God told Samuel, no, no, no. You know, man looks at the outward appearance, but I look at the heart. It ain't him. Now, Eliab is there for this, apparently. He goes through all the brothers, and then they get to David. Yep, this is it. This is the one. It says that Samuel anointed him in front of his brothers. Eliab is the one that says in verse 27, when David's oldest brother, Eliab, heard David talking to the men, he was angry. What are you doing around here anyway, he demanded. What about those few sheep you're supposed to be taking care of? Now you're trying to come for me, right? You're trying to come for me, telling me that I got to do the sheep, and you up in here in battle, trying to make like you got these whole different things, but the real issue is, you know I'm anointed above you. Don't take the bait. Don't take the bait. I know about your pride and deceit. You just want to see the battle. He tried to come for him, y'all. He tried to get him off track. But David recognized who and what the true enemy was. He didn't lose sight because he had a hater over here. I don't care about the haters. Because I see what's ahead of me. I see where God is taking me. I'm focused. Who cares if you're, I'm going to be like Tyson hitting his kids off of him while he running for the touchdown. You're going to have to work to come for me. I'm not standing there waiting. You have to know who and what the true enemy is. And some of them, it's in your family. Don't take the bait. When your family is showing that they're haters, when your children are showing that they're haters, when your friends are showing that they're haters, don't take the bait. Get the proper perspective. Know who you are in Christ. Get an accurate assessment of the situation and know who the true enemy is. We're almost done, y'all. Third point, the E. Execute it. It's time to slay. Victory awaits. Execute. 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 I'm not telling you to actually just tell it to be quiet. I said execute it. It's very different. And execution is different than me telling you to shut up. Because if I silence you, it might just be for a season. But if I execute you, you ain't re-resurrecting. What do you need to kill in your life? Confidence that is fully reliant on Christ is a threat to the enemy. David identified how the enemy was moving. He was ready to confront it by being able to really assess the situations and get the proper perspective. He's imposed to actually execute when he starts in verse 32. It says, don't worry about the Philistine, David told Saul. I'll go fight him. Don't be ridiculous, Saul said. There's no way you can fight that Philistine and possibly win. You're a boy, and he's been a man of war since his youth. Confidence in God over worry and fear will always win. David knows that he has the Lord's backing, covering, and authority to enter the fight. He's not going in blind. He's not trying to do it on his own. Others may not see it. This is what verse 33 is showing me. Others may not see it, and they may unknowingly discourage you, but don't let them dissuade you or interfere with what God has called you to do. Don't allow what they are seeing and how they see the situation to stop you from doing what it is that you know God has called you to do. Okay? Saul told him, there's no way you could win. Do y'all understand how much weight that really holds? Saul was the head of the army. The king. He was a skilled fighter. The skilled fighter is telling me I'm not going to win? If I hadn't identified the proper enemy, if I hadn't properly assessed that situation, I could have been swayed by that. Just because someone seems to be the expert, don't take expert opinions. Take God's. Take God's over expert opinions, y'all. And that's not to say that you throw out every expert opinion, but I'm just telling you. You got to have discernment. Spiritual eyes got to be opened. I want to give you an example of this, because this is something that came to me when I was studying this. It's like you have a friend or family member, and you're saying, you know what, I've identified the problem, I'm ready to confront it, and now I'm about to execute it. And you've shared that with someone. And you know what they say to you? You can't do that. That's in our bloodline. It's in the bloodline. How are you going to overcome that? It's in your bloodline. We've all been liars. We've all been addicts. We've all been sick. It's in our bloodline. When you have the mindset of it's time to execute, God is stronger than any bloodline. He's stronger than any bloodline, y'all. So I need you to understand that. Verses 34 through 37. But David persisted. I have been taking care of my father's sheep and goats, he said. When a lion or a bear comes to steal a lamb from the flock, go after it with a club and rescue the lamb from its mouth. If the animal turns to me, I catch it by the jaw and club it to death. I have done this to both lions and bears, and I'll do it to this pagan Philistine too, for he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the claws of the lion and the bear will rescue me from this Philistine. Your past experiences are preparation for your bigger victory. So you understand that David, his brother tried to be like, you ain't just supposed to be taking them little bitty of sheep. Well, them little bitty sheep is what prepared him to fight this big old giant. So don't discredit your past. If it's handled properly, it's going to prepare you for bigger victories. Do you understand that? So all those things that kind of have happened, maybe it's not just in your profession. Maybe it's things that have been done against you. Maybe it's wounds that you have had. Maybe it's different things that have been said to you that have like tried to destroy you. If you actually are in alignment with God, if you actually get it right, if you actually confront it, you have the power to execute, and God will give you victory. Next part. Saul finally consented. All right, go ahead, he said, and may the Lord be with you. Then Saul gave David his own armor, a bronze helmet and a coat of mail. David put it on, strapped the sword over it, and took a step or two to see what it was like, for he had never worn such things before. I can't go in these, he protested to Saul. I'm not used to them. So David took them off again. He picked up 5 smooth stones from a stream and put them in his shepherd's bag. Then he then armed only with the shepherd's staff and sling, he started across the valley to fight the Philistine. You have to put in work prior to engaging in the war with the enemy. Otherwise, you will try to fight in what seems appropriate, but it's too unfamiliar for you. He was trying to put on Saul's armor. That would be the appropriate thing to do when you're going to fight someone, right?
in that situation. That's what it seems like. You have to put in work prior to engaging in war with the enemy. Otherwise, you will try to fight in what seems to be appropriate, but it's too unfamiliar for you. David would have lost the fight if he would have fought with what seemed appropriate. He would have lost. But because of his work with being a shepherd, with grabbing those stones, with all of that, and knowing how to work a slingshot and all of that, he had put in prior work. He didn't just show up trying to fight. I need you to know, you have to actually put in work. You can't just be like, I'm finna fight the devil, I'm finna do this, and you ain't been praying. You don't know the word. You think you're sending demons trembling? You know demons call people out. You know, I know him, I know you, but who are you? I know Paul, but who are you? You better put in the work. You've got to put in the work. Because then you know what's appropriate. You know what's right for you. You're not going to be thrown off and putting on stuff that doesn't actually work. I knew better than to come in heels today. It would have been appropriate for me to walk around in heels. But I knew that that wasn't what was happening today. I needed to be able to move freely. Amen. All right. Goliath walked out toward David with his shield, verse 41 through 44. Bearer ahead of him, sneering in contempt at this ruddy-faced boy. Am I a dog, he roared at David, that you come to me with a stick? And he cursed David by the names of his gods. Come over here and I'll give your flesh to the birds and wild animals, Goliath yelled. I need you to understand, these enemies, these giants, they're not going to stop taunting you and pursuing you because you've decided to engage in a fight. And I hope that that doesn't discourage you, but that it ramps you up even more. That, you know what, you want to still try to come for me? It's so very different to fight somebody that's not talking trash. You don't have the same adrenaline. It's true. You know, if you already feel like you're going to beat them or whatever, and then, but when they start talking trash to you, it's like, come for me. I got something for you. A different level of fight that kind of arises in you. I need you to understand the enemy is trying to taunt. He's coming for you. He's telling you you're not going to be successful. He's telling you that you can't overcome that. He's telling you these things. He's lying to some of you and telling you it's okay for you to live the way that you're living, and it's not. It's not. It's not okay. David replied to the Philistine, you come to me with sword, spear, and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of heaven's armies, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you defied. Today the Lord will conquer you, and I will kill you and cut off your head. And then I will give the dead bodies of your men to the birds and wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. And everyone assembled here will know that the Lord rescues his people, but not with sword or spear. This is the Lord's battle, and he will give you to us. Know who your Savior is and say it to the enemy. Open your mouth and put the enemy on notice. Let him know who you are. Tell him your name. Tell him who you are in Christ. He can't handle that. Open your mouth and say it. Don't shrink back. Verse 48,
As Goliath moved closer to attack, David quickly ran out to meet him. Reaching into a shepherd's bag and taking out a stone, he hurled it with his sling and hit the Philistine in the forehead. The stone sank in, and Goliath stumbled and fell face to the ground. So David triumphed over him, the Philistine, with only a sling and a stone, for he had no sword. Then David ran over and pulled Goliath's sword from his sheath, and David used it to kill him and cut off his head. Don't shrink back as he runs after you. Go hard and prepare to execute. Cut off his head. Aren't you ready for these things to die in your life? Aren't you tired of always fighting the same things over and over? You're good for a month. You're good for 2 months. Then all of a sudden you're back in a rut. Are you tired of being depressed? Are you tired of your relationships failing? Are you tired of therapy not working because you're not doing the work to kill it? It's not your therapist's job. You gotta kill it. They can give you the tools, but you gotta kill it. Take out the sword and cut off its head. You have to execute it. You do. Your mom can't, your sister can't, your brother can't. You have to do it. The Lord gives exactly what you need to defeat the giants in your life. David had exactly what he needed. He had exactly what he needed. The last thing is, and I'm not going to read verse 52 and 53. You really need to go through and read the whole chapter on your own. But in 52 and 53, it talks about David actually killing them, and then like them, the people, the Philistines getting scared and all of that, and then all of them getting all of this plunder. You executing the giants in your life is directly connected to other people's victories. It's bigger than you. It's bigger than you. If you let the giants live, it's bigger than you. It's impacting other people. It's impacting other people when you don't take care of it. But when you do, there's victory to be had on all different types and levels. Do you understand that? There's not room enough to receive. There's plunder. You have to be willing to face the giants in your life in order to overcome them. Declaring and decreeing is not enough. David had to face Goliath to defeat him. His declaration of God's ability to defeat the uncircumcised Philistine fueled his courage to confront the giant. Knowing and decreeing who God is to those giants in your life is part of it. But it's getting face to face with the giant. It's settling that enough is enough. It's desiring freedom more than fear. It's a full surrendering and total reliance on Christ. This is what it takes to overcome the giants in your life. This is what it takes to ice those giants. Hiding from them gives them strength. Confront it. Settle it. Call God into it. Surrender it. And defeat that thing. Making sure that you're properly equipped so you can cut off its head so that it never resurrects again. It's time to come out of hiding. Stop hiding from your giants. Stop hiding from those things. Stop hiding. It's time to ice these giants in your life. Identify it, confront it, and execute it. Whether they are visible or hidden. Some of you today, We're wrapping up, but we're going to get some time because I believe that some of you actually have some giants that you want to defeat today. You can't stop at step one or step two. You got to get all the way to step three. Some of you can't ice the giant because you're partnering with the enemy. So if that is you, and you're saying, no, I actually want a true relationship with God. I want my identity wrapped in Christ. I want to be His. I want to belong to Him. I want Him to walk before me. I want Him to be my protector. I want to be in relationship with Him. I want to be able to overcome and defeat the giants in my life. If that's you today, I want you to take the time now and just raise your hand. Like, no, I want that. Yeah, that's what I want. As we are about to pray, we're going to give you guys an opportunity. Maybe there are some things that you need to call out, that you need to really confront today, and you need somebody to confront it with you. We're going to pray with you. We're going to pray with you. Those people that are going to help pray for people, if you could just come up, I would appreciate it. Don't have to remain a victim of the taunting. You don't have to remain a victim of the taunting. It's not what you have to do. Do you really want freedom? Do you really want that thing gone? We're going to invite you as the worship team is worshiping and singing, we're inviting you to come and we will pray with you. The first step is identifying it. Part of your confronting is coming out and saying, yeah, I need you to pray with me so that you can execute. So I want to open the altar and I want you to come. Please don't be afraid. Please don't be afraid. It's time. It's time for freedom. It's time for the enemy to stop having his way in your life. It's time. So I ask you to just come. We're going to open the altar and worship for a little bit and pray with those of you that know that you want prayer. Hallelujah.
Stripes, we are healed. By His nail pierced hands, we are free. By His blood, we are washed clean. Now we have the victory. Power of sin is broken. Jesus overcame it all. He has won our freedom. Jesus has won it all. Alleluia. Hallelujah, you have won it all for me.
stripes we are healed. By his nail-pierced hands we're redeemed. And by his blood we're washed clean. Now we have the victory.
The power of sin.
The power of sin is broken. Jesus overcame it all.
On high.
So we sing,
are the risen King.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you for freedom, Lord. We thank you for the freedom and the power of your blood, your resurrection, Father God. We thank you, Father God.
All of sin is broken. You've won the victory, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
It's by the power of your name. The power of the name of Jesus. Victory in the blood of Jesus. Whoa. Freedom in your name. Oh, there is freedom in the name of Jesus. There is healing purchased in his name, yeah. There is healing through the blood of Jesus. We call you Jesus.
Jesus.
We call on your name, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh,
Jesus.
Power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. Power in the name of Jesus. We stand all on the name of Jesus. In the authority of your name, Lord Jesus. 'Cause see, death could not hold you down. You are the risen. You are the risen King. You are seated in all authority. You are the risen. You're the risen King. Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You have won the victory.
It's over and done, Lord.
Hallelujah. My soul cries. You've won it. We thank you that you won it all for me, yeah.
Death could not hold you down.
No, Jesus.
You are the risen King.
Yeah.
Seated in majesty.
Nobody like you, Lord.
You are the risen King. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
We give you praise, Lord Jesus.
You have won.
We give you praise, Jesus.
Story.
Come on, y'all. Even those in your seats. Come on, give him worship. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
We thank you, Jesus.
You have won it all for me.
Oh,
death could not hold you down.
Death could not hold.
You are the risen King. Seated in majesty. You are the risen King.
Finished work on the cross.
death could not hold you down. You are the risen King, seated in majesty. You are the risen King. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Spirit of God is still moving in the house. Hallelujah. And there'll still be people here to pray afterwards if you need prayer. And you are welcome to come down. Hallelujah. But why don't we raise up on our feet? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Lift your hands before the Lord, and I'm going to give the benediction. And if anyone else still needs prayer, you're welcome to come forward. Father, we're so grateful today, Lord God, for the word that has been given to us, Lord God, by your servant, Latay. Father, you want us to walk in the victory that you've called us to. Father, you want us to walk as your servants, as your children, victorious, Lord God. You sent your son so that we might have victory, O God. You sent your son so that we would be overcomers in this world, O God. So, Father, we thank you for the word, O God. We thank you, Lord God, that it is said and it is done, O God. We thank you today that we can walk in victory. Father, I pray, Lord God, in Jesus' name, that your people would take hold of the truth, take hold of the identity of Christ, and walk. We thank you today, oh God. Now go before your people. Bless them that they would walk in victory. Bless them that they would walk with the mind of Jesus Christ. Bless them that they would walk in victorious ways, oh God. Bless them that they would discern the way of truth, oh God. Give them the victory today. And you will be glorified. And you will be exalted. Your name will be hallowed in the earth. In the mighty name of Jesus, let every heart say, amen and amen. God bless you today. Hallelujah.